the first day of the Christian year as we begin the season of Advent, and so truly, it is a new year when we get to begin to think about the ways that we desire to draw nearer to Christ in this season when we prepare our hearts for his coming and his birth. So I'm so glad that each and every one of you are here or worshiping online with us this morning. As always, our bulletin, as well as our giving link and a way for you to let us know that you are watching, are pinned to the top of our Facebook page, and we would love for you to fill out whatever you are comfortable with this day. I've got just a couple of announcements. Hopefully, you've already read some of these in your weekly email. The first of those is you will notice in the back of the sanctuary, the poinsettia forms are out. If you would like to give a poinsettia in honor or in memory of someone during this season of Advent, we invite you to fill one of these out. Each of the poinsettias is $11, and we want you to turn these in by next Sunday. Okay. By next Sunday, if you could turn these in, you can leave them in the offering plate or mail them into the church office, and we will get them taken care of. You may have also noticed in your email that came out this week, we are going to be collecting a love offering for the lay members of our staff, for Jessica and Larry and Nell and Lorraine. And so if you would like to contribute to that Christmas love offering for them, we just ask that you write a check to the church and designate it for staff love offering, or give cash and put it in an envelope that is labeled that same way, staff love offering. You can put it in the offering plate. We're going to collect that money, and then staff parish with those funds is going to be able to give a gift to each of the members of our staff this year. So if you have any questions, feel free to talk to Randy, who's the chair of staff parish, or me, and we would be happy to help you. This has been such a strange year, but all of our staff have worked incredibly hard every single week of this year to make sure that we could have worship, that the operations of the church could keep going, that we could keep paying the bills, all those sorts of things. And so we are very grateful to them. Finally, you will remember that it is Yellow Envelope Month when we collect for the different mission projects that are listed on our yellow envelopes. You can find these with the offering plates in the back as you leave today. But we have a need specifically right now that we would love for you to give toward with these yellow envelopes. And that is our backpack ministry. One of the things that is we are in dire need of in Greenville County right now is food. There's a lot of food insecurity that is happening due to job loss and other concerns with COVID-19. And so one of the ways that our church is seeking to love our community is we are continuing to pack these bags. Each and every week, 10 of these bags are going to students at Summit Drive Elementary School right across the street who otherwise would not have food to eat on the weekends. And so each of these bags costs us about $4 to pack, but in the bag, each student gets two entrees, two breakfasts, a vegetable, a fruit, a sweet, salty crackers, and a treat like popcorn. So we're supporting these kids over at Summit Drive, but we need your help in order for us to be able to finish out the spring semester and the school year strong. So if you'd be willing to give a little bit today to support our backpack ministry, just put it in your yellow envelope as you leave today, and we'll make sure that it gets to the right place. Well, this Advent, we are looking to hear many different things in the midst of a world that is chaotic. We are going to hear some words from the scriptures that are words of comfort. We are going to hear words of challenge and also words of good news. This morning, the prophet Isaiah and the four gospel authors were writing in a time when people desperately needed to hear these kinds of words as well. This first week, Isaiah the prophet and Mark the gospel writer, who published first, reassure the people that good news is coming. And yet they both say, make yourself ready, raise your voices, change your heart, Get ready to be transformed, because now is the time. So as we enter into this season of Advent, let us embrace hope that we can do what needs to be done to bring light to this darkened world. Join us as we sing together our opening hymn, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. And we are going to sing both verses this morning.
Thank you. Our Old Testament scripture this morning is from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up, do not fear. Say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. See, the Lord comes with might, and his arm rules for him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead the mother sheep. My friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
One of the things that we hope that we are going to be able to do in this Advent season is to begin to bring the light of Christ into the world, to be able to share the goodness that we have experienced with Christ and to share that light with all the people that we come into contact with. And so every single week of Advent, we are going to learn a verse of this little light of mine in sign language to help us to remember to be shining our light as we go throughout the week. And so this is a participatory part of worship, and I expect all of you to help me out this morning so I don't look crazy. All right, so we're gonna learn just the first verse this morning of this little light of mine, and it starts like this. This little, I promise you it's gonna be easy, you can handle it. This little, and you're gonna make a candle, light, like this. It's like, y'all can't see me. This little light of mine, and then you're gonna point at yourself. I'm gonna let it shine. All right, we're gonna try that again. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Okay, and then you know how the song goes, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Okay, we're gonna try it. You can, if it's too much to sing and to do it, I will sing and you all practice your hand motions. All right. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Perfect. I hope that you all will carry that with you this week, and it will serve as a reminder that everywhere you go, particularly in this Advent season, we are hoping that the light of Christ would shine throughout this world, especially in this dark season in which we find ourselves. So I expect you to practice so you'll be ready for verse 2 next week. But as we continue in this time of worship, I hope that you will think and you will reflect on the ways that God might be calling you this week to allow your light to shine, to give of yourself financially, of your gifts, of the talents that you have been given to share with this world, that the entire world might be blessed. So as Jessica plays this morning, would you reflect on the ways that God is calling you to shine your light?
Our scripture this morning from the New Testament is taken from Mark chapter 1, verses 1 through 15. In the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight.'" John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locust and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart, and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, You are my son, the beloved. With you I am well pleased. And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild beast, and the angels waited on him. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." My friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, friends, I know it is hard to believe coming immediately off of the celebration of Thanksgiving, but already in the life of the church, we can see signs all around us that Christmas is coming. As I mentioned earlier, we know that today is the first day of the new Christian year, this season of Advent, the 4 weeks that lead us up to Christmas, that allow us time in the midst of the hustling and the bustling world to slow down, to be still, and to prepare our hearts for the coming or the birth, the advent of Christ Jesus our Lord. So throughout the season of Advent this year, we are going to follow a particular theme. We are going to walk through the opening pages of each of the four Gospels, the four books within this entire library of Scripture that focus specifically upon the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus. We are going to linger each of these four Sundays at the beginning of one of the Gospels to see how each of those particular biblical authors interpret what the coming of Jesus is going to mean for the world. We can have read Scripture hundreds of times over the course of our lives and assume that the gospel writers all have the same thing to say. But there is a reason that we don't just have one gospel in our Scriptures. We have four, because they all saw the story a little bit differently. And so that I hope as we explore each of these openings of the Gospels, we will discover something new that will help us to believe, even in these uncertain times. So as we prepare our hearts this morning for the Gospel of Mark, would you pray with me? Gracious and holy God, to be in this place in a spirit of worship is nothing short of a gift. We thank you for being in this place, for allowing your Holy Spirit to fall upon each and every one of us to make us ready for the word that you are going to speak over our lives this day. Holy God, I pray that above all else, you would speak through me, and you would speak with me, and you would speak in spite of me. That above all else, your gospel would be preached. It's in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus, that we pray. Amen. Well, in the midst of masks and sanitizer and case numbers, you probably missed it. But in August of this year, a plaza was opened in Roanoke Rapids, North Carolina, in honor of a woman named Sarah K. Evans. Now you might be thinking right now, Rachel, I don't think I missed that. I don't even know who that is. It doesn't sound very interesting. And I'd have to admit to you that until this week, I didn't know her name either. But Sarah Evans was a private in the armed forces who in 1952 found herself on a bus on her way home from a brief leave from her first military assignment. When unexpectedly, midway through her journey from New Jersey, the bus changed drivers. And Sarah was asked to move to the back of the bus to make room for a white gentleman from the military that was boarding. But Sarah refused to move, instead holding her ground right where she sat until police came and arrested her and detained her in jail for over 13 hours, sticking her with a hefty fine. She went on to sue the Interstate Commerce Commission for their prejudice against her, and 3 years later, she would win that case in court in November of 1955. Though its anti-discrimination outcome would not be enforced until 1961. In March of that same year, 1955, another young black woman, a teenager named Claudette Colvin, was riding the bus home from high school one day when the bus driver told her she needed to get up and make way for a white person. Having just studied in class earlier that day the remarkable effects of Sojourner Truth and Harriet Tubman, Claudette refused to move. She was arrested, her school books flying as she was dragged off the bus. Months before Rosa Parks would ever refuse to give up her seat on that infamous Montgomery bus ride, Sarah and Claudette had already done it, paving the way and preparing the ground for Rosa Parks' actions to garner attention and to ignite a revolution, a boycott, as a part of the civil rights movement that would absolutely change our nation and our world. Sarah came before Claudette, who came before Rosa. When we turn to the opening pages of Mark's gospel, we should be immediately caught up with the abruptness of it all. Mark is not going to ease us in to his telling of the good news. He's not, as we will see with some of the other gospel writers, going to slow us down with a detailed account of Jesus's birth. He's not going to take it all the way back to the beginning of time to show us how this man's particular story fits into the grand scheme of the world. He's not going to bore us with a genealogy of where this Jesus guy comes from. No, he's simply seems to be hoping that we've got our seat belts buckled and are ready to go, because by the end of chapter one, Jesus is already going to be a dignified adult, baptized, tempted, preaching, and healing. Talk about blinking your eyes and your little baby boy growing up. But because Mark is in such a hurry to get to the good stuff, that should give us even more reason to pause and to make sense of why he starts where he does. He announces very abruptly his thesis of the entire book that he is writing that is to come, the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. But then he jumps in, not with Jesus, but with Isaiah. And then with this little fellow named John the Baptizer, who even by biblical standards is a little odd. Why would Mark start there and not with the guy whom the season and the story's all about, the one whom everyone has been waiting for? Isaiah is a prophet from over 500 years prior who was preaching to a people lost and stuck in the throes of the Babylonian exile, far, far away from their homeland, from their customs, from their place of worship, from their familiar and comfortable spots. He tells the depressed and the downtrodden Jewish community to whom he is speaking to have hope. For there is one who is coming who is going to help them to find their way home. But, Isaiah continues, it's their job and his. In those moments in time in which they are waiting to prepare the way, to do like the old legend claims the servants of royalty used to do, to travel ahead before the important one who is coming, and with a little shovel to get down towards the ground and to fill in the low places and to smooth out the high ones so that his or her highness would have a smoother and easier journey to go. They are to prepare the way for the one who is to come. Then we read about John the Baptizer, who kind of seems to fit that bill, who hundreds of years later shows up in camel's hair and leather, eating bugs for breakfast and a little honey sweetness on top, who marches not through the center of town, but on the edges of society, the wilderness, the wasteland, coming to the ones whom Jerusalem had cast beyond her borders and making those with means and fortune walk a little bit farther, really want it, really desire to come to where he was. But even John says, it's not about me, but someone more powerful who is coming after. I am here to prepare the way with nothing more than some water. And in these moments, John seems to predict that even after this one who is to come, there will be another who will follow, a spirit from Almighty God, and the story will go on and on. Isaiah, who came before John, who came before Jesus, and the Spirit. I don't know about you, but every time I read the opening pages of the Gospels that contain the telling of John the Baptizer, and hear Isaiah as well, I never feel like John gets a very fair shake. Like Sarah and Claudette, who had to wait nearly 70 years to get any kind of recognition to the vital role that they played in the beginning of the civil rights bus boycotts, I feel like standing up and shouting that it is about time that John got some recognition too. I can only imagine the work and the time and the effort that he put into helping the world to prepare for Jesus. Time spent preaching and preparing the good news of repentance and the forgiveness of sins. Moments of his life given to proclaiming the life change from turning from one way of living to another. Helping people to confess the worst sins that they'd ever done and the worst things they'd ever been, baptizing them that they might get the first glimpse of the power of what a new life could bring. All of that he did not for his own glory, but because his one job, his one task for which he had been sent, was to point to the one who was to come. To run out in the streets like that little servant did for the royalty, to fill in every valley with that shovel and to smooth over every hill and bump to bring it low, all for just one paragraph in the opening of Mark's gospel and thousands of words to follow where your name is barely even mentioned. But this year, as I read the opening of the story of Jesus, as I read those pieces about Isaiah and John, I realized how significant it is that they even get mentioned in Mark's gospel at all. Mark, who doesn't even have time to tell us about the manger in the stable and Mary great with child, he makes room for a paragraph, a whole paragraph committed to John and Isaiah before focusing solely on the Son of God. And you know why I think Mark does it? Because I think he seems to realize that the story couldn't have been focused on Jesus without the effort of Isaiah and John. The story couldn't have been focused on Jesus without the effort of Isaiah and John. Two examples in a long line who get next to no credit, but who played one of the most significant roles, doing tasks that seemed as menial as filling in divots, just to have a role to prepare the way for the life-changing God in flesh to come from heaven down to earth. Just like those women refusing to give up their seat that Rosa Parks might have a breakthrough, they sit in the background of the story of Jesus, that truly Jesus can be the hope of the world. I don't know about you, but I want my life to be like that. To be so committed, so full of love for my Savior that I wouldn't do anything with next to no credit, not even a sentence or a paragraph, but simply for the fact that the world might come to know him. That we sang this morning at the beginning of worship likely was one that was not familiar to you. But each week of Advent, we are going to learn one of its verses as a part of our Advent wreath lighting. And I hope that you will take its words to heart. The text for that song comes from a poem that was scratched and found on the cellar wall, written by a Jew in the Cologne concentration camp during World War II. And I believe that its writer wrote these words not only as a sense of hope in a time of horrible despair, but as a way also prepare anyone who would read it, who were living in those horrible conditions, to prepare them for the freedom, for the new life that they hoped would come. Hear these words of that poem. I believe in the sun, even when it is not shining. I believe in love, even when there is no one there. I believe in God, even when he is silent. I believe through any trial, there is always a way. But sometimes in this suffering and hopeless despair, my heart cries for shelter, to know that someone's there. But a voice rises within me, saying, "Hold on, my child. I'll give you strength. I'll give you hope. Just stay a while. May there someday be sunshine. May there someday be happiness. May there someday be love. May there someday be peace. Dear friends, how can you do your part to begin to prepare your little corner of the world for the advent of Jesus, for the coming of the light, the hope of this world? It might seem simple, like keeping your seat or getting out that shovel or scratching on the walls of a cellar the words of hope that are buried deep within your heart. But who knows? The little thing that you do might also prepare the way for the very thing that changes the world. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, may it be so. Amen. This morning, as we come to worship, as we think and we dream and we process the ways that God is calling us to be His light out in the world, we realize that we are people who come who have things for which we are sorry, things that we desire to confess, to get off of our hearts, to make room for the one who is to come. So today, as we prepare our hearts to go before the Lord in prayer, I want to invite you to join me in this litany of belief, in the ways that we have fallen short, and in the ways that with Christ we seek to do better. Would you join me? I believe that we have looked the other way too many times, and I believe that we are capable of facing reality and working for change. I believe that our fear of difference has robbed us of compassion, and I believe that we can look deeper and hold on to the things that we have in common. I believe that our fear of doubt makes us stop asking tough questions, and I believe that asking tough questions is faithful. We believe even when we are discouraged. We believe that when we are discouraged, Christ will offer us hope. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we bring before you this day these statements of belief. These ways that we have fallen short in the midst of your world and have not shined your light and your goodness in ways that were meaningful and true. We ask, O God, that you would forgive us, that you would open us to a new way of life and of hope and of peace and of joy and of love in this season of Advent. That all that we say and do would be a reflection of who you are and who you are coming to be in Jesus. God, we thank you that in the midst of a dark and a hurting world, in the midst of a year so unlike any other that we have ever seen, that we know that you have journeyed with us and will continue to do so every single step of the way. That you will give us the energy for the journey. That you will give us the light that shines within us, that you will give us your spirit that we might be alive with you, that you will give us hope where it seems like there is none. God, we trust that you are with us, that that is the name of your Son, Emmanuel, Jesus, God with us, that you mean for that to be true. And we thank you and we praise you for that this day. God, we lift up before you this day every single person in the midst of our community and beyond these walls of Northside United Methodist Church who is hurting. Every single person who had to sit at their Thanksgiving table this week by themselves. We ask, oh God, that you would surround them with your presence, that you would open our eyes to see who they are and where they are, that we might be a companion in this time of need. We pray, oh God, for every single person in the midst of this community who is sick, who is wondering if this week or this day will be the one when they or their loved one take their last breath. We pray, oh God, for your comfort and for your peace. And we pray that we might find creative ways as a church to show up in the midst of their hurt and their confusion. God, we pray for every single person who doesn't know where their next meal is coming from, who doesn't know if tonight they will have a roof over their heads, who wonders if this will be the day that their electricity gets cut off. We pray that we would put our money where our mouths are, and that we would help as we are able all those who are in need and who are struggling in this time. God, it is so clear that you have made us to be your hands and your feet, your very body in this world. And we pray that we would live up to that challenge. That in this season of Advent, and particularly this week, we would be your hope in the world. God, we thank you for the gift of Jesus. And the joy that it is to celebrate his coming in this month. And we pray that we would not take that for granted, but that we would lean into it with our whole lives. And in honor of who he is and all that he showed and taught us as he walked on this earth, oh God, we pray now in the way that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This morning, as we continue to prepare our hearts for this season, would you join us as we sing together, O come, Emmanuel, truly God with us. And would you feel the spirit of these words? This week, dear friends, may you go forth into this dark and this hurting world. And may you be a preparer of the way. An Isaiah, a John, a Sarah, making the way for Jesus and his light to come into this world. May it be so. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen.